I need my mirror so I can read my scripts. That's right behind it. Hi guys, welcome back to another episode of Crew Time. If you are new here,
hi,
my name is Sarah, and what I do here is tell you a terrible story to ruin your day and put on my makeup at the same time. So if that sounds like a fun combination to you, you are in the right place. So make sure that you subscribe to this channel, hit the bell notification, and then you will never miss one of my terrible stories. So this week's story is super duper hot in the Crew Time news. It's funny, maybe not the right word for it, but I had missed this entire case. I didn't even hear about it until it went to trial, and then it was everywhere. It's very recent. It only just wrapped up last week, or maybe even barely 2 weeks ago, but we're gonna get into it today, and it is terrible. This is the story of Letitia Stauch. Okay, so a couple of things. First of all, the story is really convoluted and twisty-turny confusing, so I'm gonna try my best to streamline. There's a lot of details, and I can't include them all, or we're gonna be here for days and days and days. So it is what it is. Also, I don't really feature the makeup as I'm using it, but if you're interested to see what it is that I'm putting on my face, look down in the description box, click the link, and it will take you to it. At 6:55 p.m. on January 27th, 2020, the El Paso County 911 received a call from 36-year-old Letitia Stauch at 6626 Mandan Drive in the Lorson Ranch neighborhood of Colorado Springs, Colorado. She was calling to report that her 11-year-old stepson, Gannon Stauch, was supposed to be home from a friend's house about an hour before that, but he didn't show up, which was unlike him. She said she also checked around other homes in the neighborhood, but couldn't find him. Well, the 911 operator transferred Letitia to the non-emergency line. Non-emergency line. Apparently, Letitia did not seem to be upset, alarmed, scared, hysterical. You know, the way that you might expect a mom to be acting when her kid is missing. Apparently, she was very calm and collected, so she reported Gannon's description, the clothing he had been wearing. She said that he left their home at around 3:30 or 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and he had been playing outside. Remember, it's January in Colorado. She said that he was a really good kid. He hadn't been in trouble recently. He was a straight-A student, you know, all the things. This wasn't like a runaway kid, in other words. When the operator asked Letitia who the last person to see Gannon was, she said, I guess me. So Gannon was pretty quickly entered into the national database as an active runaway. And the reason for this is because in the state of Colorado, when a child that's age 10 and up goes missing, they're automatically listed as a runaway first. So by 10 p.m. that night, deputies from the El Paso County Sheriff's Office came to the Stauch's home to meet with Letitia. She told them that she had gone to several of Gannon's friends' houses to look for him, and she also sent her other daughter, teenage daughter Harley, to the park to look for him. Gannon's father, Al, was in the National Guard, and he was actually in Oklahoma for a couple of days for training, and he wasn't supposed to be home until the next day. Well, Letitia allowed the law enforcement officers to do a preliminary search of the house, kind of take a little look around. As they were walking around the house, Letitia made sure to point out, you know, some areas that might look like they're of concern, but there was an explanation. For instance, there was a spot on the carpet that Gannon had knocked over a candle the day before and had burned the carpet so badly that she had cut it out. Okay. The deputies didn't really find anything super concerning, no evidence, but they did find her behavior to be kind of weird. You know, it wasn't sitting right. By the next day, the case was turned over to investigators for more resources. So the next morning, Letitia drove to the airport to pick up Al, who was flying back home from Oklahoma. This was at about 9 o'clock in the morning. She drove her Volkswagen Tiguan to the Colorado Springs airport and parked it in short-term parking. Then she went to the Avis rental car counter and rented a Kia Rio. Weird? Yes, it's weird. We'll come back. Well, she picked up Al and then they drove the car back to their house. Why did she need to rent a car? Especially something smaller than like her regular car? It's weird, right? Okay, so apparently Letitia's Tiguan was a lease and you know, miles are limited. So apparently she was getting really close to her limit and she figured that they were gonna be driving around a lot looking for Gannon, so she rented the car. Anybody believe in that? I mean, you're telling me that this child is missing and you're concerned about fees for extra miles on your lease. Girl. Okay, so as the search ramped up, now it's Tuesday, January 28th, Letitia and Al were interviewed by detectives to try to provide any leads that might be helpful in finding Gannon. And this interview was conducted at a Starbucks. Why a Starbucks, you ask? Apparently, Letitia didn't want detectives at their house.
What?
You guys, are you keeping track of the red flags? So many. Okay, so after that interview, they went back to their home, to the neighborhood, and by now the entire community had come out to help look for Gannon. Several of Al's National Guard co-workers actually came back with him to help search for Gannon, and Gannon's mom, Landon, who lived in South Carolina, had come into Colorado to search as well. So many people in the community that had come together to help search for Gannon would later say that while Al appeared to be, you know, totally devastated and frantic to find Gannon, Letitia, not so much. She was kind of smiling and acting like she was sort of like at a barbecue. So what do we know about Gannon? Gannon Jacob Stauch was born on September 29th, 2008 in Florence, South Carolina to Eugene Al Stauch and Landon Hoyt. Al was serving in the Army National Guard for South Carolina at the time and Landon worked in education. She was a teacher, like I'm pretty sure elementary or maybe middle school. Anyways, when Gannon was born, he was actually a micro preemie. He was born 4 months premature. He weighed like a pound and a half or something wild, and he spent months in the NICU. Doctors actually expected for him to suffer a life of extreme physical disabilities, if he even survived at all. But, I mean, aside from some tummy trouble and some ADHD, like all of us, am I right? He was a pretty healthy kid, you know, just a regular boy. About 3 years later, Al and Landon welcomed another child, a girl named Lena, and Gannon was a really great big brother. Gannon Stauch was a typical kid, you know, he loved sports and he loved video games. He was probably more of an inside kid than an outside kid, you know. Well, Al and Landon's relationship didn't last, you know, and they eventually divorced. And when they split up, Al took primary custody of the kids. By January of 2014, Al met a lady named Letitia Lynn Hardin while they were playing on various softball teams in the Myrtle Beach area. Letitia was actually also a school teacher, but we'll come back to that. So Letitia Lynn Hardin was born on August 4th, 1983 in Lumberton, North Carolina. Her stepfather was physically and sexually abusive, and she actually left home by the age of 16. She graduated from high school in 2001 and got herself into some trouble. No surprise with that kind of family life. She actually stole a car, and was put on probation. She had a couple more charges of varying degrees over the year, but according to her LinkedIn profile, Letitia got her shit together. She graduated from the University of North Carolina, Pembroke, with a degree in political science. Then she earned her master's degree in curriculum and instruction from Capella University. Then she earned a doctorate degree in education from Liberty University. Now, hang on a second. I'm not saying that her degrees aren't real. The schools are all accredited, but I'm squinting. She was licensed to be a school teacher in the state of South Carolina and then later in Colorado. So before she met and married Al Stauch, she had been married to a man named Chase Hunt. They actually had a child together, a baby girl that they named Harley, and that marriage didn't last long and they got divorced. I'm really skimming over the details here. Well, Letitia worked for a time in Horry County Schools in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina from late 2010 to the summer of 2015, according to LinkedIn. And towards the end of her tenure there, she had met and married Al Stock, as I mentioned. By then, her daughter Harley was like 12 years old or so. Now, Letitia's teaching history is a little strange. So she worked at a few different schools and had a lot of trouble. You know, particularly in the Marion County School District. They actually suspended her teaching license after she abandoned her duties. So let that be known, okay, if you don't formally resign, the school will come for you. Take your license. Apparently, Letitia claimed that she was being harassed by Al's ex-wife, Landon. And that's why she quit her job. I guess Landon's uncle was like the superintendent of schools or something. There was definitely a family connection, but like, where was the evidence of this harassment? Okay, so anyways, by 2015, Al had taken a position as a recruiter for the National Guard, and he got sent to a position in Alaska. And Letitia was not excited about moving to the last frontier. So Letitia and her daughter Harley stayed behind in South Carolina while Al and his two kiddos moved up to Alaska. Well, Letitia and Harley would come to Alaska and visit for a couple of weeks at a time, but the distance just, you know, was taking its toll on their relationship. And Letitia made it known that she was not happy with this arrangement. So actually during one of those visits, Letitia alleged that one of Al's co-workers sexually harassed her. And Al was not having it. Meaning he was gonna defend his wife and his family. You know, he's a good guy and he wouldn't allow that kind of behavior to go unchecked. So he took it up his chain of command and it eventually turned into Al being transferred to Colorado Springs, Colorado. Well, moving to Colorado suited Letitia just fine because she and Harley actually moved to Colorado before Al and the other kids arrived from Alaska. She got her teaching license sorted out so that she could get a job in the state. They found a really nice home to live in. Everything seemed to be just great. Why does any of that matter in the case of Gannon? Letitia was a master manipulator. We now know that those allegations from the co-worker in Alaska were just totally made up. But she knew that Al would do anything to stand up for her and stand up for what's right, so she used it to her advantage. Okay, so back to the timeline. The investigators have come to the Stouks' home and they were squinting. You know, Letitia's story kept changing and they were catching on pretty quickly that she's kind of full of shit. So now Al is home. Family members have also come to Colorado to help to look for Gannon. So in the house that night was Al, his sister, his ex-wife, Gannon's mother, Landon, Letitia, the kids, Harley and Lena, and I think that's it. So at this time, Landon was actually staying in the Stouks' home with them. I guess upset Letitia, but also the kid is missing. Like what? This ain't about you right now. So Al and Landon had really come a long way in their relationship and they had struggled over the years, especially with custody arrangements and things like that. Eventually, Al took primary custody of the kids and Letitia was just like super duper jealous of Landon, you know, didn't want her anywhere near Al. The police were conducting interviews in groups and individually. And after Al had sat down with police by himself, he started to question things. The story just wasn't adding up. Letitia told him that she parked her Volkswagen SUV, the Tiguan, at French Elementary School, where she worked as a teacher. She said that she parked it there to make room for out-of-town guests' vehicles. You know, people that were going to be coming into town to help search for Gannon. What? So Al actually drove past the school and, you know, wouldn't you know it, the car wasn't parked there because we know it's at the airport. Also, didn't she say that she rented the vehicle to keep the miles down on that SUV? He knew she was lying, but he didn't understand why, but he knew it wasn't good. Also, by this time, Al had reviewed some Ring camera footage from neighbors. Remember, Letitia claimed that Gannon left to go hang out with some friends, so there would be footage of him walking down the sidewalk. No, none from any of the Ring camera footage or similar like surveillance security camera footage from neighbors. Nothing. No Gannon. So with that and Letitia's like nonsense explanation of this rental car, Al confronted her and he demanded to know the truth. Well, hold on to your butts, friends. Letitia Stauch told her husband Al that on the night before Gannon disappeared, he was playing his Nintendo Switch when he wasn't supposed to, and when he, it seems like he thought he heard her coming, you know, that she was gonna bust him. So he like scrambled a little bit and then accidentally knocked over a candle that burned a hole in the carpet. It actually set fire to the carpet and filled the basement up with smoke. Very dramatic. Letitia said that she saw smoke coming up the stairs and she freaked out. She grabbed Lena and their two small dogs and took them outside to safety, you know, to Al's truck. Then she went back into the house for Gannon and she picked up a blanket and smothered the fire in the basement with the blankets. And then they both ran outside, got in the truck, and then they left. And she was so panicked and she didn't know what to do, so they just kind of drove around for a little while. And then they went home and opened up the windows and aired the basement out. Later on, she noticed that Gannon had some burns on his arms from, I guess, the candle. So she put some aloe and bandages on it, and then she had to cut the damaged part of the carpet out, and she told Gannon that they were going to have to sell his prized Nintendo Switch and maybe even some of the furniture to pay for the repairs so that the landlord wouldn't evict them. And by the way, she recorded herself making those threats to him about having to sell the stuff so that they wouldn't get kicked out. Gannon is like crying and apologizing, and it's just like really messed up, that kind of like mental trickery, abuse, you know, that she's doing on this kid. She said that she and the girls slept upstairs in her bedroom and Gannon slept downstairs in the basement, you know, with the windows open in January in Colorado. Okay. There's actually a different version of that story from Letitia where it's not a big serious deal and there's no smoke and they didn't leave the house. And she told Gannon everything was fine, okay, no big deal. What? She also said that that evening, Gannon was having some stomach trouble, spending a lot of time on the toilet, the green apple quick steps, you know what I'm saying. She decided that she wanted to keep him home from school because he didn't get much rest and also was obviously ill. And she actually had a conversation with Al about that, I think via text message. The next day, Letitia contacted Gannon's school and told them that he would not be coming in. She also called herself out of work, saying that her stepfather had been killed by a car. What? I mean, you could just say, my kid's sick, have to stay home. Or, I don't feel well, have to stay home. Like, they're gonna go with the killing the stepfather, huh? Okay. Also, by the way, the stepfather had died 14 years before that. So Lena went to school that day and Harley went to work. So it's just Letitia and Gannon in the house that day. Letitia needed to run some errands. So she brought Gannon with her, you know, sick home from school Gannon. So many problems with this story, you guys. Like, I can't even keep it straight. Letitia said that she drove to an area of their subdivision where it was still under construction, and she stopped a man who introduced himself as Edgardo. She asked if he could get some of the same carpet that they use in all the houses to help fix that damaged spot in the basement. And she gave him the address of their home and the code to enter through the garage. And according to her, he was supposed to execute this repair while she and Gannon were out running errands that day. What? She gave a random man the code to their house. Okay, so after that, Letitia and Gannon drove to run these errands. They went to Petco to buy dog outfits twice. She couldn't decide what to buy. Then they went to Dunkin' Donuts and to get gas somewhere. She couldn't remember where. The Ring camera then showed her arriving back to their house about 2:19 p.m. She says that when she got home, she was upstairs getting ready to clean the house and work out. She said that she had her headphones on, but she heard a noise coming from the basement, so she went downstairs to investigate. And when she was headed downstairs, Edgardo popped out of the storage room, holding a gun. You guys, she knew that there wasn't any money in the house. So she said, take whatever you want, just please don't hurt us. So then he sexually assaulted her. Well, now it is the afternoon and Lena is going to get home from school any minute now. He actually allowed her to run upstairs to greet her and then tell her to go outside and play. Again in January in Colorado. Also, what? She could have just escaped? What? Now, when she returned, now Edgardo has Gannon at gunpoint. He's threatening and then Gannon tries to like defend her. There's like a physical attack. Edgardo throws Gannon across the room. He hits himself in the head like really hard. Blood is everywhere. It's a whole scene. Edgardo demanded a suitcase, so she gave it to him. And then he struck her so hard that she got knocked out. And then when she woke up, Edgardo and Gannon were gone. Does she call the police? No. Does she call Al? No. So she decided the best thing for her to do would be to clean it up. Clean up this mess. Conceal it. You know? She started tidying up the room, straightening it so it didn't look like anything happened there. She cleaned up all of the blood. In fact, in the middle of cleaning, she stopped and texted Harley, who she knew was going to be home soon, or maybe she was home by then, and asked her to, you know, go to the store for more cleaning supplies, like carpet cleaner, baking soda, trash bags. Okay, so spoiler alert, none of the sexual assault nonsense was true. There is no Edgardo. We now know that during that morning when she was out running errands with sick home from school at Gannon, she turned her phone off and left it at home and didn't turn it back on until 2:45 p.m. Also, during this time that she was supposedly being sexually assaulted, from 3:30 to 4:30, she was texting back and forth with Al the entire time. So Al, like, you know, the rest of us, wants to know why Letitia didn't call the police. You know, 911. She said that she felt responsible. You know, she had given this strange man the code to get into the garage. So dumb, silly, and she knew that Al would be so angry with her. She felt ashamed because of this sexual assault, and she panicked, and she didn't know what else to do. You guys.
The lies! There you go, this bitch. The lies.
On January 29th, Letitia had an appointment to speak with police at 10 a.m., but she arrived 2 hours late. We now know that she was at the car wash cleaning her Volkswagen SUV inside it out. She had returned that rental car earlier that morning, and when she finally spoke with investigators, she was generally pretty evasive. She also had arrived to the interview with like several sheets of notebook paper, like notes. She asked if she could just read her notes, you know, so that she could keep things straight. I mean, no wonder. It's a pretty convoluted story. Letitia. Also, that's very weird. You know, when you arrive to speak with police, you don't bring notes. Well, she told them that Edgardo nonsense story. The investigators did note that during this interview, you know, within just days of this attack, no physical injuries on her. They also offered to take her to the hospital to administer a rape exam, to which she declined. Okay, so Letitia basically shared a lot of details with investigators. And it's clear now that she was trying to explain in advance things that they hadn't asked about yet. She's trying to cover for things that she thought they would find. For instance, she mentioned a few days before Gannon disappeared that he was in the garage and he cut his foot on some woodworking tools that Al had in the garage. And his foot actually had bled a lot. She had him sit on the back of her Volkswagen, like in the tailgate, and bandaged his foot. So the police in their investigation and the search of the home had definitely used Blue Star and Luminol. They had definitely found blood on the back of her Volkswagen, but she didn't know that because they hadn't told that to anyone. Why was Letitia explaining evidence that she is not supposed to know about? I mean, not to mention all this ring camera footage from the neighborhood doesn't show Gannon walking at all. And also, no random Edgardo construction man lurking about. Okay, so Letitia's interview with police that day was voluntary. She's free to leave at any time. It wasn't until they started asking about collecting DNA samples from her that she started acting really cagey. It was at that point that she started making every excuse she could possibly think of. You know, she's hungry, she needs to eat, then she has a headache, then she needs to go check on her daughter. I mean, she was just like really trying everything. Now, they were already squinting at her. They did not believe her, essentially, from the day that they arrived at her house when Gannon disappeared. But it wasn't until she started explaining away the evidence that she wasn't supposed to know about that they decided to detain her and then get a search warrant for her phone and her vehicle. So then, Letitia started having chest pains and needed an ambulance. Well, they called for help for her, you know. The ambulance came, took her to the hospital, and when she got there, she made a miraculous recovery, and then she left without telling anyone. The point is, for somebody to have claimed to have been sexually assaulted in her home and her kid had been abducted, she wasn't cooperating at all with investigators or authorities, and that's real weird, man. So at this point, the Stalks' home was determined to be a crime scene, and the family had to vacate the property temporarily. They moved into hotels. Well, Letitia and Harley decided that they wanted to go stay with family in South Carolina, get out of town, you know. Al, Landon, and the other kids stayed in Colorado to help continue the search for Gannon. Well, searches for Gannon continued in El Paso County, Colorado for like the next 2 months. And as I mentioned earlier, Gannon's status was changed from runaway to endangered missing child on January 30th. So this allowed local law enforcement to get resources from the FBI and the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children to, you know, help. So the investigation and search started to expand out by this time. They started searching out by County Road 105 after reviewing GPS data from Letitia's Tiguan. It had driven out there the morning after Gannon went missing. So there's news clips, interviews, press conferences featuring the parents, Al and Landon.
Again, and Daddy loves you so much. Please come home.
I have hope. So please have hope with me. I'm begging. Bring my baby home. Bubba, I love you. Mommy loves you so much. Nova loves you. Lena loves you. This room is filled with people that love you, and this community loves you too. So please come home, baby. Please come home.
Their attitude is much different than what you see from weirdo Letitia. I'm sure you've seen it, but it's just like... What?
When you get here, you'll be able to truly tell what happened. And then I really hope I get a sincere apology from everyone.
Well, Al wasn't believing anything that Letitia was saying either, and their marriage was essentially over. By this time, there was like a full mountain of evidence against Letitia that was undeniable. Investigators had also gathered enough blood evidence from the house, blood spatter, luminol, to know that Gannon had been murdered there. They just didn't have his body. Now, although Al didn't believe anything Letitia was saying, he was really the best bet that investigators had in getting information out of Letitia, getting her to talk. So in mid-February, the FBI started working with Al. He was very cooperative, and they were doing these recorded, staged phone calls. He would sit with an agent and they would coach him through these conversations, trying to, you know, just keep her on the phone, keep her talking. She literally gave 6 different versions of events. We're gonna run through them as best we can. They're crazy. So in the first version of the story, the abductor Edgardo was still in their house when the deputies came and she was trying to signal them, but it didn't work.
Wow.
In the second version of the story, she identified the man as Quincy Brown. He had been the one to sexually assault her, and the reason that she knew his name was that she saw his ID card fall out of his pocket. Side note, Quincy Brown was somebody that was in the news at the time. He had been recently named as like a most wanted person in Colorado. In another version of the story, a man followed her from Petco, and at some point got in front of her car, was laying down in the middle of the road, and, you know, when she stopped to avoid hitting him, he jumped in the car and made her take him home with her, and then he raped her.
Sure, Jan.
In a fourth version of the story, Letitia and Gannon were near County Line and Highway 105 in North El Paso County that day. Gannon was riding his bicycle in the area and he fell off and hit his head, and then he was abducted by a man.
Weren't you afraid?
No, ma'am, but they tied me in a big sack.
In a fifth version of the story, she talked about how the person who had broken to the home and assaulted her anally violated her and Gannon, and that's why there was blood everywhere, and then he abducted Gannon.
How did you escape?
I didn't. They chopped me into firewood.
And then in one of the last versions of the story, and my personal favorite, was when she was on the way to Petco, she saw a very visibly pregnant woman walking down the road, possibly hitchhiking, and she felt bad for her because the woman looked, you know, very pregnant, very uncomfortable. So she stopped to give her a ride, and then when the woman got in the car, she pulled up her shirt to reveal that it was a false belly, and all inside the belly was like a bunch of cash dollars. And then she said that the not pregnant lady wanted her to drive around to Mexican restaurants to launder this money, but, you know, but she wouldn't. You guys, it's the creativity for me. You guys, these are just the versions of the stories that she told Al. You know, she told investigators even more crazy tall tales. She told Special Agent John Grusing that Al wanted to have a threesome and they had met a girl named Angel using one of those hookup apps. The girl had even babysat their kids. She wasn't specific about whether or not they actually did do this threesome. She also could not describe this woman, give a last name, didn't know where she lived, also could not pull up the app that she was talking about. But she did say that this Angel person abducted Gannon from Petco.
Perhaps you haven't been telling the truth, Pinocchio.
Perhaps.
Okay, so on February 18th, 2020, Letitia contacted a company called FakePolygraph.com. Apparently, she had placed an order for a fake polygraph test result. With these companies, you can like send in custom questions like, no, I'm not cheating on my husband. No, I didn't spend that money. Some stuff like that. Well, apparently, she called this company because she could not get her report. It wouldn't show up. She didn't understand why. And then they told her, your report was actually blocked because of the content of the questions. They basically refused her service because the questions that she was asking the test to say were things like, did you participate in any way causing your son's death?
Like instantly, I was like, yeah, no.
Well, a few days later, the search was officially suspended. You know, it's winter, there's snow everywhere, they're not making any progress. Also, it's pretty clear that Letitia murdered Gannon. A warrant was later issued for Letitia's arrest. On March 2nd, 2020, investigators from El Paso County and FBI agents went to Myrtle Beach, South Carolina to arrest Letitia and charge her with the first-degree murder of Gannon Stauch. And you guys, when she was being extradited back to Colorado from South Carolina, she tried to escape. Apparently, they were using like a rented minivan, and you know, there were three armed deputies in the vehicle with her. But as they're driving along, high rate of highway speed, she slipped her hand out of her handcuffs and she had like a full can of a Monster energy drink, and she tried to smash it into the deputy's head and then tried to open the door to the van while, you know, they're screaming down the interstate. I mean, this attack happened when they were traveling through Kansas. And they're lucky that nobody was hurt. So Letitia is now in custody, but on March 17th, 2020, in Pace, Florida, you know, just near Pensacola, a man that was conducting a bridge inspection discovered a suitcase in the marshy area underneath the bridge. And when he checked it out, he noticed it was unusually heavy. And when he went to open it, the smell about knocked him over. He said he saw two little feet wearing football socks. He called the police immediately, and the remains were later determined to be those of Gannon Stauch.
The Highway 90 bridge over the Escambia River near Pensacola, Florida. It was a road construction worker who found the remains Tuesday. Investigators aren't releasing any details about how the boy died. They say he was killed in Colorado and then taken to Florida.
The medical examiner determined that Gannon had been stabbed 18 times, had been shot in the jaw, strangled and had a severe skull fracture. He had defensive wounds on his hands and arms, and his body, because it was so decomposed at the time that it was discovered, the medical examiner was unable to say which wounds occurred first, but they did find in the toxicology report that he had hydrocodone in his system. So how the hell did he end up in Florida when he disappeared from Colorado? Well, let's back it all the way up to January 27th, 2020. We can reasonably piece the timeline together based on the full scope of evidence. So, Letitia and Al's marriage was straight up falling apart. You know, she was very resentful of his children and how much work she felt she was putting into raising them. Internet search history from her phone indicates that she was looking for apartments and employment in other states days before Gannon's murder. Letitia kept Gannon home from school on Monday, January 27th, 2020. She took pictures of him sleeping in bed and sent them to Al that morning. Then she took him out with her to run errands using Al's Nissan truck. She left her cell phone at home. Gannon is not seen on any surveillance photos or footage from inside Petco or any other stores, so he must have just been in the car. But his phone indicates searches occurring for things like, can my parent find my phone when it is turned off? They both returned to the house at about 2:19 p.m., something like that. Letitia had very likely drugged Gannon with the hydrocodone because she's seen kind of like helping him into the car, like maybe he was really sleepy. She very likely strangled him to death or attempted to. This physical attack then escalated to the point where she stabbed him 18 times and somehow struck him in the head and then also finally shot him, all in his bedroom. Then at some point, Lena came home from school and Letitia shooed her outside to play while she cleaned up the mess, including these blood-soaked linens that disappeared because the linens in that picture from the morning are different than the linens that were on the bed when investigators showed up that night. She then stuffed Gannon's body into that large suitcase and at some point carried it up from his bedroom in the basement level up to the garage and then into the back of her Volkswagen SUV. She had backed that Volkswagen into the garage because there's blood on the back bumper and then on the floor in the garage where that back area would have been. In addition to the suitcase was the bagged up murder evidence, the blood-soaked linens and all of those things. She put it all in the back of her car and then called 911 to report Gannon missing. The next morning, she drove that Volkswagen Tiguan to the airport and traded it out for that rented Kia Rio, picked up Al, got home, then later that evening, Letitia returned to the Tiguan and then drove it out to a remote area in southern Douglas County, disposed of the suitcase. She then returned the Tiguan to the parking lot and drove the Kia back to the house. Then on the morning of January 29th, Letitia returned the Kia and then took her Tiguan to the car wash for a very careful cleansing. After Letitia spoke with the police, they seized her vehicle, so she got herself into another rental car via her mom or aunt or someone that was in town to help find Gannon. This was a Nissan Altima. Investigators knew about this and they placed a tracking device on it, unbeknownst to her. And on January 31st, 2020, Letitia drove out to the area north of Palmer Lake in southern Douglas County, Colorado. At first, investigators thought that she was just checking to make sure that this evidence, Gannon's body, was properly concealed, but what she really did was recover it. The next day, Letitia's stepbrother, who was in town to help search for Gannon, Dakota Lowry, he helped Letitia load up a van that she had rented. You know, she intended to move out of Colorado to South Carolina with Harley. He noticed that Letitia was struggling to kind of lift one of these suitcases into the van. She said it was full of old softball stuff. Over the next 3 days, Letitia and Harley drove that rented van through Texas, Louisiana, Alabama, and Florida. She and Harley were going to Florida, according to Harley, to look for apartments. On February 4th, 2020, Letitia checked into a hotel in Pensacola, and she dumped that suitcase off of a nearby bridge. She eventually continued that journey to Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, where she returned that rented van. Over the next couple of weeks, investigators were combing over all of the evidence that they had pulled from that home in Colorado, and there was a lot of reactions to Blue Star and Luminol, all kinds of blood in Gannon's bedroom, in the garage, and in Letitia's Volkswagen. At this point, media coverage was publicizing everything about this case, and they were talking about the search for Gannon that had expanded into the area near Palmer Lake. And Letitia, in conversations with Al and investigators, came up with some bullshit alibi, of course, to explain why she might have been in that area, although no one ever asked her. But by this time, it didn't matter because she had already moved the body that she'd dumped there many, 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 many miles away. In mid-February, Letitia tried to obtain that fake polygraph test result to somehow prove her innocence. Roughly a month after dumping Gannon's body off of that bridge, it was discovered by the bridge inspector, and Letitia had already been arrested and extradited to Colorado. Letitia Stauch was charged with murder in the first degree of a child under the age of 12 by someone in a position of trust. Also, child abuse resulting in death, tampering with a deceased body, tampering with physical evidence, one count of first-degree murder after deliberation, and 8 counts of committing a crime of violence. So those last 8 crimes of violence are sentencing-enhancing charges, FYI. While Letitia was in jail awaiting trial, she wrote crazy letters to the judge. They were full of crazy ramblings. They were talking about how they were plotting against her to poison her with using peanut butter, and how she needed help, and how she wanted to represent herself legally because her lawyers were in cahoots with the prosecution. The courts ordered a psychiatric evaluation for her, but she was cleared as competent to stand trial. Initially, Letitia Stauch pled not guilty, but just before the trial began, she changed the plea to not guilty by reason of insanity. Whoa, 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 whoa. That means that she's admitting that she killed Gannon, but, you know, was just out of her mind. You guys, this trial. I wasn't able to watch every waking moment of it like I have other trials, but this woman looks like a fucking maniac. If you watched any of this footage or even like the pre-trial hearings, it's a whole lot of crazy. So during testimony, for example, Letitia would like stare down the witnesses to like try to intimidate them, you know, or she would giggle. It's really disturbing. She was also caught flipping the bird to like Gannon's family or whoever was testifying. Like what? So on May 8th, 2023, so this just happened, Letitia Stauch was found guilty on all counts. So the state of Colorado does not have the death penalty, but the judge did impose life in prison without the possibility of parole, in addition to some other consecutive sentences to be served.
As Gannon's family continues to grieve, Letitia Stauch is now heading to prison for the rest of her life.
He is not forgotten and never will be.
Now family, friends, and the community that tirelessly searched for him can begin healing, always remembering the happy little boy Gannon was.
Always Gannon strong. My gene meant forever. Justice been served today.
The judge also admonished Letitia for claiming mental illness as the reason or motivation for her actions, saying that it did a disservice to those who sincerely suffer from mental illness. And I agree. And that is the wild story of Letitia Stauch. It was a long one, and it's going to take me 18 years to edit. And I left out so many details. I know, like, if you've been following this case, you're probably just like, oh, you forgot about this. Oh, you forgot about that. I know. There's a lot. Again, if you're interested to see any of the actual makeup that I used that I didn't talk about or point out, look down in the description box. Everything is linked. If it's not available, I will show you something similar. If you have a true crime story that you want to recommend to me, I would love to hear from you. There's a Google Doc down in the description box. Just click the link, fill it out with all the gory details. So I think that's it. Thank you so much for hanging out today. I really appreciate it. If you want to see more videos like this one, then consider subscribing to this channel before you leave today. I upload new videos here on YouTube every week-ish. And you can follow me on most of the other socials as well. That is it for now. I'll catch you next time in the next video. Bye! Okay, I need my mirror so I can read my scripts. That's right behind it. Prove her evidence. Nope. That contour though. Dakota Lowry. 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 To help continuing the search for Landon. Nope. His name's not Landon. in Colorado. Nope. It was most definitely human relate. Relains? What's a human relane? Someone please tell me. Claimed that. Come on. I'm just making my nose look stupid. Yes.